chapter C, he describes the bond between humans and the natural world means we live in an integral ecology. Dee Dee and I were just discussing this the other day. She's a lot more familiar with ecology than I am. And she said that one of the things that is lacking in this definition is love. There's a bond, okay, there's a bond. But new humanism goes farther than to say there's a bond. New humanism challenges you to see yourself in everything, to feel it's all a part of you, it's all your family. There's a love implied there. There is a bond, and this is not a bad idea. This is very close to new humanism. And the secondary part of integral ecology is that to solve problems, a synergy between science, policy, and religion is required. That's very good. I think new humanism would go farther. Integral ecology could be applied to how we relate to each other during this conference, how we use our energy, whether we use up somebody and throw them away and put them in the compost heap, or whether we take care of our resources and make sure they're all properly utilized. Integral ecology can be applied to everything in life. And I have a feeling in this school, you're doing that. You're calling it neo-humanism. So integral ecology is very close to neo-humanism, and it's a very popular term, something that millions and millions and millions of people are familiar with because it is being promoted by the Catholic Church as a new paradigm for how we interact in the world in a Christian way. The next term, which is one that I like the most of the three, is compassion. I wrote here, compassion is a spark that upon finding the right tinder, ignites an ever-growing fire that consumes and transforms everything it touches. That is something that came into my mind when I was at a retreat in California, and I climbed up this mountain, and I sat there, and I suddenly realized that compassion, once it gets started, is an unstoppable force. You know, it may begin with a feeling of compassion for other people. Something that came after World War II, a desire to end wars through bringing together a United Nations. But it doesn't end there. It starts with a compassion for other people, but then there's compassion. When I was young, there was compassion for whales, but not for chickens. But those of you who know chickens know they have personality, and they're affectionate. And why do we stop there? Eventually, this is the thing about compassion. Once it gets started, it can't stop. And this quote is something that came into my mind as I was meditating. This has only happened to me a few times in my life, just like someone was saying it to me. And this is a quote from the author of Neo-Humanism. Only their spiritual lives become successful whose minds are deeply pained in the gloomy touch of human sorrow, whose minds sparkle like rubies and emeralds with the tears of joy and laughter of all beings. That's a perfect definition of compassion. Why didn't we just call this compassionate education? We could. It would be very close. We could call it universalist education, we could call it integral ecology, we could call it compassionate education. And in fact, I recommend that you think about using those words when you talk about new humanism with parents, with children, assuming they're old enough to understand some of these things. But it's still not all the way there. One of the things I found in discussing compassion is people talk about, well, I don't have compassion for mosquitoes. Do you expect me to love them too? And it's a difficult question, because at some point we have to have compassion for ourselves. And compassion has been often synonymous with passivity, with nonviolence. And if someone was to come here and threaten your life, I would want to protect you, and I might have to apply force to that person. Does that mean I'm not compassionate to them? there are several things to weigh. The same thing is true about an insect that is potentially carrying a disease. So do we torture the insect to death? Okay, I just want to a better life. I offer it a good wish. No, seriously, I do. But a lot of people have trouble with compassion because they do equate it with a kind of passive nonviolence that ultimately devalues your own life. It's a form of weakness. So let's get to in my own humble opinion, this is why the author came up with a new term. That these three terms, which I think are very close, aren't quite there. And he called it a new humanism. I just wrote a new humanism because it's founded in the humanist movement. I don't have time for that during this presentation. That could be a whole day. The humanist movement, he's giving a new energy to it. And it starts with this. This is a verbal quote that I didn't mention during my experience that I had 20 years of opportunity to spend with the author of New Humanism, and this is one of the things that he said. When the sweetest touch of the human heart, okay, I'd like to stop right there, because that's your lives. The sweetest touch of the human heart is the sentiment between the mother and their child. There is nothing sweeter. That's something we already know. We know how precious it is. We know how powerful it is. We know it can cause us to do all sorts of heroic and illogical things. It's something we're familiar with. But this next part is something that is a real challenge. Extends its embrace to the entire animate and inanimate worlds. Now, there are those who can imagine extending that sweetest touch of the human heart to all the members of their family, to their extended family, but to extend it to everyone, everything, and even the inanimate things, that means the walls and the rug and the projector here, the papers hanging, everything, that's hard to imagine. That isn't going to happen by thinking about it. It has to happen through a number of vehicles, and one of them is experience. It has to come partly from a transcendental experience. So when the sweetest touch of the human heart extends its embrace to the entire animate and inanimate worlds, this is neo-humanism. So it starts with something we already know, the love in the family. And then it challenges us to redefine what is family. Now, when the United Nations was made, humanism was behind it. But in the original phase, it made the mistake of putting human beings above everything else and separate from everything else. Now the United Nations actually doesn't follow that anymore. But humanism, the author of Neo-Humanism often said, would not be able to solve the world's problems. So now, my dear brother asked me to cover several points. And one of the points was, why do we need this? So I'm going to bring up a question mark, and the question mark represents why do we need this. And there's an answer there that I'd like you to read on your own, because in the background is a soundtrack of a rapper who came to our school and interviewed the children about what kind of world they'd like to see. What kind of world do they imagine for the future? Because this is why we need new humanism, to fulfill their dreams. At the time he came, he also happened to be there in New York when we were having the Occupy Wall Street movement. So he combined sounds of that too. I hope it plays for you. Why do we need neo-humanism in the world today? Okay, the volume isn't working. That's so sad.
Oh, sounds.
There you go.
blasted through some speakers here. Bruce didn't have a chance to practice that, so you might not have caught all the words, but I have that if you want to hear it sometime. So the next piece is, how does this apply to education? This is a very complicated answer. So we have tried, I say we, I mean many of the experienced educators around the world have come together and simplified it into three pieces. There are many, many, many more pieces, but for the sake of our understanding, let's simplify it to a heart piece, a mind piece, and a societal piece. Those are little people. Okay, we'll start with the heart piece. Expanding the heart to a universal love. What is a universal love? That takes a closer look. I have tried to teach this to children in so many ways, you can imagine, over my lifetime. And this, I have found, is the best way for me. It's a series of simple questions that any five-year-old could answer. And I turned it into a song at one point, but I don't want to be performing right now, so let me just go through it. The first question is, what if life were a circle that held everyone we loved? Kept them safe and happy, would I be inside the circle? You can do this with children, have a draw circle, and then you come around and say, how come I'm not in there? Maybe you would be in there. Can you grow it? Is your heart big enough to let more in? Please tell me, what of the creatures? There's a lot of children, they'll think that you can do this as an exercise, they'll imagine their pet. Then I would say to them, what if a stray dog comes up to the house and needs your help? What if somebody finds an abused dog? Now, what about all the ones you can't see? Of course, children care about all of them. You don't think about it as being in your circle. The flowers, the trees, and the fragrance on the breeze. The fragrance on the breeze represents the inanimate. And the second section of questions, and of course you can change this if you don't want to use the word God. What if God drew a circle to hold everyone he loves? Just how big would he make it? Would it go around the world? That's a difficult question. Would Australia be included? Would the White House be included? Would the whole or even greater, a bigger circle than that around the world? Would the whole universe fit inside his cosmic circle? And what if we could draw a circle like that? Would we know the heart of God? So these are a series of very simple questions that make a child think, because children want to think about whether there's a supreme being. How much love do we need to expand our heart to a universal love? Now the second part of this is the techniques. There are several techniques that we've been using over my lifetime at the school to develop this kind of love in young people. The first one is the example of the teachers. That no matter what you say, it's what you are and what you do that they're going to watch and remember. And they'll try it on when they become teenagers. I remember Miss So-and-so and I'm going to be like her. The second way is through select stories, literature, and I call them extension activities. We'll get into that this afternoon, if any of you will be in the elementary workshop. The third is through meditation, and this is where I had thoughts about a divergent path and giving you a big talk about meditation, but if there's time at the end, I'll do that, but I would like to think about meditation in a different way. I would like to think about meditation as an I am statement. I'd like you to think about all the ways you define yourself. And meditation is really just a different way of defining yourself and finding out who you are. Service. I'm assuming that the River School children engage in service to the community.
Yeah.
How about service to those who are in need outside the community? Because I don't think of Mulaney as a very needy community. And finally, through creating that micro-society You have your own classroom micro-society, you have your River School micro-society. Everywhere I go, I've seen these little posters, a River School family, expectations. You know, that's part of creating your micro-society. So you can talk about love, but if you have a war going on in your classroom and you can't handle it, that's what the children will learn. So the ideal micro-society, and now I want to move on to the second piece, which is the mind. Freeing the mind, the liberation of intellect. And what does that mean? This is a generalization, but I picked up the most important points I could think of. Synchronously with everyday teaching, it means while you're teaching a child how to read, while you're teaching them which way is north and which way is south, we should also be training minds in the ideals of neo-humanism. And I have a sense that maybe Anne is looking for this kind of information. How do you do what you need to do, what the government asks you to do, what parents expect you to do, and at the same time, train the children in the ideals. And some of these ideals are cultural vitality, rationality, expansion, self-knowledge, and then I have a whole section here of attitudes, creativity, curiosity, wonder, delight, and aesthetic sensibility. Determination and motivation, rigor and discipline, striving for excellence, freedom from geographic and social bias, appreciation for the systemic universe, analysis and synthesis. Each of these could be a class on its own. Let me just take, for example, appreciation for the systemic universe. When we teach science, there's an opportunity for us to expose children to the reality that there are systems within systems within systems, and that there's, it implies that there's an intelligent design of these systems. The atom is not random particles running around. It follows a certain systemic order. They combine to form molecules in a certain systemic way. It's very similar to the way these stars and planets move in a systemic fashion, the way we can predict the seasons and such. So this is often neglected in the teaching of science, and wow, boy, I'm going to go on a rant if I'm not careful. This all goes back to Newton and his discovery of gravity, and his the effect of that was that people felt that we don't need God anymore because we understand how everything works, and therefore we're the masters of this place. That's Newtonian physics. But to get back to how those goals are accomplished, by reimagining and recreating content in all academic subjects. And that's part of what I'd like to get into with elementary teachers this afternoon. By creating a school cultural environment through the content and character of the art, music, drama, dance, foreign language, and nature curriculum. I think actually that there's a lot of art and music and drama and dance and those things going on here, but I'm not sure that the content is always in line with neo-humanism. I know that I have that problem in my school, and that's a separate topic I'll be addressing tomorrow, which is the effects of the so-called pop culture on our attempt to bring about a school artistic culture. Through progressive methodology, that means help. There are ways to get learning into long-term memory. It's been fairly well proven that filling in bubbles on a sheet is not the way. That's short-term memory, but long-term memory often comes from, Dee Dee and I were discussing this yesterday, what do we remember that we did all our lives? We remember things that involved drama and celebrations, things that were very interactive, went into long-term memory. So there's methodology specific to neo-humanism to help children to really learn things, which is remembering them long-term and then applying them in their life. Through the example of the teacher, again, so everything is going to be on you. You know, unless your mind is free, unless your mind is trained, no matter what you do, they're going to watch your example, and your example is key. And finally, by adding new subjects to the traditional fare, meaning menu, So perhaps some of my words are not your Aussie English, so I felt like this needed a closer look, because I really thought there really is no way to train the mind unless we add all of these things at our school. And these are things that we've added to the curriculum that are not a part of the state mandated curriculum, that no other school is doing all of these things. Some of them might do one or two. But unless we do these things, we find we're not able to properly train the children's mind. So there's a twofold approach. One part is adjust, and the other is add. Adjust the science curriculum, add alternative health to it. Adjust the social studies curriculum, add current events and debating. Now, as you all probably know, we're in a very difficult situation in the United States politically. And this has affected the children. So the teenagers will come in, they used to be friends, and now they're, who did your family vote for? They voted for Trump. Well, do you know that he wants to send my family back to Haiti? You're an idiot. And it degenerates into name calling. And I hate Muslims. I hate Muslims. My name is Donald Trump. I have little children going through the hallway saying this. And of course, I hate Muslims, and I hate Mexicans too. So, it was a very funny story, actually. Sad but funny. One little boy was saying this in the hallways. I'm Donald Trump. He was pretending to be Donald Trump. He's Mexican. Of course, Donald Trump didn't directly say those things. He only implied them. And I said, this was on the day after Muhammad Ali passed. And I said, in that case, you're going to have to find a new hero and a new school. Because this boy's hero was Muhammad Ali. I said, your hero who just passed away was a Muslim, and the lady who started the school was a Mexican. So now you have no school and you have no hero. Anyway, these extra things, and you may do some of these extra things, are very critical. We were unable to design a proper neo-humanist curriculum and train the mind without adding things that weren't there, which is a difficult thing to do because it means taking away time from other activities. Now I want to move on to the social piece. Engaging in society, moving together. What does that mean? I leave this to the Paramecium to explain. We want to create a social outlook and social practices that are inclusive, fair, forward-looking, and fearless. School learning helps opinions to form that are based on a broad spectrum of facts, imbued with a sense of rational justice, but this learning only becomes real when directed into action for the service of the greater good. Ecological realization should be embedded into the social curriculum and integrated into all aspects of personal and collective life. I was tempted to use the word awareness, but I think awareness isn't good enough in terms of ecological awareness. So this is what social outlook means. It means, who's a part of our family? How do we treat someone who is suffering? How do we treat someone who's stealing time and energy from the class? How do we resolve problems between us as adults? Now, we have an advantage over you. And it's probably the only advantage we have at Progressive School, and I'm speaking now to the River School teachers, but I think this may apply to all of you. All of our classrooms have partnerships, and that partnership is essential for demonstrating how adults with different personalities can solve problems and get along. Because when adults fail to do that, the children notice, and they will also not be so inspired to do it themselves. So social outlook is a very important part of neo-humanism. And how do we get there? Again, this is not my theory. This is how we have gotten there. successfully for many years with the children who have, I've interviewed, who told me how we got there. How did you become such a socially conscious person? By teaching of cardinal ethical principles. By providing opportunities for service and volunteerism in all subjects. By applying learning to real-world situations and problem-solving. By proper study and debate, especially in social studies and history. The proper study means looking at all sides of a question and then analyzing the sources of information as to whether they can be trusted. That's what proper study means. And what is missing from this list? Somebody tell me what's missing from it. Something's missing.
Modeling, teacher's modeling.
Something that was in the other ones.
Yeah, leading by example.
Example of the teacher. So, since the three main aspects of neo-humanist education, which is expanding the heart, freeing the mind, creating a social outlook that is more just and expanded, they all depend on the example of the teacher. Therefore, we have to be working on ourselves in a neo-humanist school. We're not just technicians delivering information. This leads to my next circle. Why is this style of education, Mano asked me, why does the world need it? Why is it important? How are we to develop? And those are the points I'm covering. It makes learning relevant. In our school, kids never ask, why do I have to learn this? I mean, that's all I did in school. It brings joy to children, parents, and teachers. It unites the children of the world with common ideals. This is a beautiful thing that I learned actually from Narada. We went around and interviewed parents in schools around the world, and they all had similar experiences. And I have done the same with children and find they all have similar ideals. And when our children start to wander away from quiet time, I don't want to come, I don't want to do it, I don't like it. I remind them there are children all over the world who are doing this. Not just you. We're doing it together. It will provide a perennial source of hope for our stricken planet. I wanted to end there, but the rant in me came out. I'm really angry about this. There's a crisis in education in this world because so many countries have adopted a narrow definition that education is preparing our citizens for the job market. That's a total failure of imagination because there's a situation now, if the goal is to train the workforce, 65% of the jobs these children will get when they grow up aren't even existing yet. And this is done according to the World Economic Forum research. And it's very reputable. So children need to be trained to think, to filter, because information, they don't need you for information anymore, they have their cell phone. To creatively problem solve, to separate sentimentalism from rationality, and to care. These things aren't going to be taught by Google. They need to learn how to do these things. And I would also say they need to learn how to work together. Many, many times, parents will say to me, I don't like that my child has to work with two other children and it's affecting their grade. Well, part of life is working with other people. And if you talk to almost any employer in America where children are not being taught how to do this, they're very upset that these people don't know how to collaborate in the office and solve a problem. Mm-hmm. That's my rant, but I had another one coming. Yeah, I'm going to try to just limit myself to what I wrote here. Who we are is not defined by the sophistication of our stuff. Okay, 9 years ago when I came here, we didn't have these. Doesn't change who I am, doesn't change the information. A monkey driving a car is still a monkey. You can put it in a suit, it's still a monkey. Our internal life, our social life, our ethics, who we are, how we act, how we treat each other, how we interact with other beings, our quality of life, all of these have not kept pace with the external changes in the world. So we find ourselves largely the same as a human race. Largely the same, unchanged, unimproved. But with tremendous physical wealth, physical knowledge, weapons, and technology. Simply said, technology has outpaced human development. And there's this idea that that's not education. I had a mom come into the school from India, and she said to me, "That's my job. That's not your job." And I said, "But didn't you tell me you have a full-time job?" So if a mother is working full-time and she's allowing YouTube to raise her child, how's she going to be able to train the human being? Education has ignored the inner person and the wisdom of the ages for too long. That's just my statement about why we need new humanist education. It has to be about training the human being, not just about giving them the information they need. And I don't think families can do it on their own anymore. They just don't have the time. And they're also battling all of the external forces that take down the values they're trying to transmit. So anyway, these are the reasons. Now, those were the reasons, let me back up for a second, why this style of education is important. And now I'm going to move into how do we grow as new humanist educators. Now we're going to play a little game. You have to forgive this person because they spoke 400 some years ago. And this is a bit of a sexist statement, but I don't want to reword. Education begins the gentleman, but reading, good company, and reflection must finish him. Does anyone know who said that? Call it out if you think you know.
Somebody wrote about men a lot. Could be anybody.
John Locke, the philosopher. And I chose this quote because we had 6 weeks with our teachers where all we did at every meeting was share ways of personal development that each of us has discovered. One woman talked about her program with using essential oils. Another one talked about a book that she had read. Someone else talked about a place where she goes and talks to people. So it boiled down to reading, good company, and reflection. And then I found this quote. I said, well, somebody knew that a long time ago. So let's start with the reading part. Once you learn to read, you will be forever free. By one of the greatest Americans that ever lived. He was a slave. Any guesses? The great orator, spokesman, writer, Frederick Douglass. One of the most brilliant people ever. So through proper reading and study, we can grow as educators. Through keeping good company. Everything in this universe is the expression of the divine or of consciousness. So you have no right to hate anybody. There is spiritual potentiality in all people. Some people have harnessed it, and these people are able to help other people to arouse it. Some people will arouse it if they are in the company of those who have already awakened it. This is the importance of good company. Your duty is to awaken yourself and help others to awaken. I find that divine effulgence in the face of everyone. No one is inferior. No one is degraded. You must know who's the greatest. He's the founder of New Humanism. This is his statement about... Now, there are lots of great quotes about keeping good company. I happen to like this one, but there are so many wonderful quotes. And, we had discussions before this retreat about this, and you can't really qualify who's good and who's bad all the time, okay? But you can be aware, if you have the capacity to bring everyone who's you're with up, or whether they're going to bring you down, that's a way of judging whether you're going to be keeping good company. So for example, if I'm at a bar with 50 people, that might bring me down. I don't think I have the capacity to raise them all up if they're all in the mood for drinking and carousing. But if I take 3 people out of that bar who want to have, you know, an interesting conversation about the meaning of life, that might be good company. So good company—it's relative. It has to do with whether you're going to be elevated by keeping this company, or whether it's going to do you in. And the third thing on the list was through introspection. I called it personal practices and intuitional science. I want to take the mysticism out of it for a moment and say there's a science here about looking deep within your own mind. Heed these words, you who wish to probe the depths of nature. If you do not seek within yourself that which you seek, if you do not find within yourself that which you seek, neither will you find it outside. In you is hidden the treasure of treasures. Know thyself, and you will know the universe and the gods. Any guesses?
Yogananda. Yogananda.
I couldn't hear you.
A biblical statement.
A biblical statement.
So
back farther.
A Greek statement.
A Greek statement. Okay, that's 3,500 years old. Somebody knew these things before us. Okay, that should have ended it, but I couldn't stop there. My son would never forgive me if I didn't include this. We're spending time in the natural world. Now I'm preaching to the choir, because I thought I was in the natural world when I go in my backyard, and then I come here, and now I know what the natural world really is.
Nothing yet.
So one touch of nature makes the whole world kin. Very wise fellow said this. Yes, communing with nature, spending time alone with nature, is the natural way towards evolving, towards human evolution, towards spiritual evolution. Meditation is a way of speeding that up, but it's going to naturally occur as we recognize, as I said, the systematic order and the interrelationship of things. There's something, I don't believe it's random and accidental. And finally, this great quote. Through attending Gurukul training workshops led by Marcus Bussey, is it?
Yeah.
Okay, that was said by.
How much did he ask?
He said that. That is said by me. I state that is another way for us to prove ourselves as educators. Okay? Now, finally, the final piece he asked me to explain is, how about neo-humanism and progressive school? Well, that is such a big topic that I decided to only pick one thing. So we have adjusted 28 leading features of school life, such as second grade reading list, okay? Social studies curriculum in fourth grade. Well, I call that subject matter. Course offerings. What kinds of things do we offer children? We offer, for example, we have a club after school called the Club of Big Ideas. Mm-hmm. And they learn about every major philosopher from ancient times to the present. Mm-hmm. And you would not believe how capable they are about discussing these things. And they're so passionate to know what have people come up with so far for how we should live our life, why we're here, where it all came from, what's the point. Where is it all headed? So that has to do with course offerings, instructional methods, policies, and teaching duties. So 28 different things. When I say policy, something like policy would be a homework policy. What's the policy on completing homework, or how much homework there should be? So every aspect of school life, we have looked at it through a neo-humanist lens. And this is first done as a philosophical exercise. We just do it as an exercise. How would neo-humanism affect this? How would neo-humanism affect our policy of admitting children or expelling them? Then, it's implemented through specific methods, practices, or content. Now, you can imagine, this took 20 years for us to do, and this was the work of, we have 27 people on our staff. So this was the collective work of 20-some people for 20 years. But I, just for the sake of pricking your interest, and I'm sure you've done similar work, I picked one thing by the Happy Paramecium. Mm-hmm. Parent-teacher communication. That's just one aspect. So here's the philosophical exercise. It's a little hard to read, so I'm going to get up close. Neo-humanism challenges us to see ourselves in everything and see everything within ourselves. With parent-to-teacher communication, the teacher can begin by putting herself in the parent's shoes. It takes a lot of imagination sometimes, especially when they're on the attack. Mm-hmm. That's not usually the first instinct to let me put myself in her shoes, is let me fight back. Simply put, we want a team relationship. Anything that puts that team spirit in jeopardy may also put in jeopardy a child's progress. And the more members that are active on that team, the stronger it becomes. We must always remain open to family observations, no matter how different from our own. Emotions are in abundance for all parties when it comes to the growth and welfare of children. That's a very important statement. There was a study done in America on the most emotionally taxing job, and it came out as being teacher. Teachers are extremely attached to the results of their work and to the people they work with. These emotions can interfere with rational problem solving. Overcoming emotional thinking is a key component of good communication for all involved. It is imperative to create an environment wherein there is an agreement of purpose, where solutions are sought for collectively, and where differences of opinion add to the wealth of ideas. So this is a philosophical approach. How are we going to, and then we have to come up with specific policy and method. Well, how do we do this? This is just an idea. So this is what we've done as an intellectual exercise, applying neo-humanism to pretty much every aspect of school life. And I couldn't really go further than that in the time given. So we're going to zoom back out. And that is the molecule of neo-humanism. Thank you.
Minutes for question time, question and some dialogue. Questions, of course, can be directed at a room, but if other people want to join in on a question answer type thing, feel free, because we're in a community here. It's not that a room is going to be the talking head and it's sort of the oracle of Delphi, okay, the oracle of neo-humans. But it's over to you guys. Now, things that came up for you, things you'd like to have clarified, things you'd like to have example of, so on.
My goal in this was to give an overview of what new humanistic education is, why it's important, and in that realize that we have to grow as educators. One of the key components of new humanist education is it looks as the teacher as a mini guru for the child, not just as an employee. Someone to transmit information, and I believe that all of you have that kind of relationship with your children. I see it even in the vacation area. There's so much care for these young people. I feel the need to go back to the meditation piece. If there aren't too many questions, but if you feel the need to have anything clarified with me, this is a way of visually organizing
and a talk. So I can step through at any point, go back to any circle, or review anything, or try to answer questions that come up. Yes.
Eric, you had a list on board of different ways we can change curriculum so that they parallel the ideals and goals of neo-humanistic education.
Yes.
One of those was biography. Mm-hmm. Can you explain that?
Thank you.
That one to me, please.
Is that here?
Yes.
Oh,
yeah, I think I know my points,
okay.
But just the biography one, what is that?
So, biographies are very rarely included as a part of school curriculum. You might be teaching something about Australia's history, and you may include a few details about some individual, but the full story of someone's life can be a very, very powerful thing. Now, I'll tell you a brief story about this. One of the things that I've come to understand is that the most powerful way of teaching children, meaning that it affects them and that they remember it and they enjoy it, is an integrated method where you combine many different modalities. You combine literature, poetry, science, art, music, and so on. So we have a biography unit for our second grade, which for us would be age 7. It spans the course of 6 months, a little bit at a time. A lot of research, which involves reading. Okay? A lot of artistic work, a lot of dramatic work. There's costume design, there's public speaking, there's writing and spelling. There's so much involved in this, but in the end, what we have, which is something that Dee Dee and I very much agree on, is a celebration. And how we evaluate the children is through the celebration. The celebration we call it the Living Museum. And the Living Museum is the entire school body, which is ages 5 up to age 14, come and watch the 7-year-olds. We have a stage. And the 7-year-olds are sitting in costume as the person that they've chosen who most affected them when they learned these biographies. Now, as there's a very specific format where they give a quote, I believe, one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. That's what I believe. That would be a good way to start it, okay? That would be Neil Armstrong. My name is Neil Armstrong. They say something about themselves, and then they have to challenge the audience. What do you believe? Or they give a more specific question. For example, one girl was Malala, and she at the end she says something about what are you prepared to lose to make the world a better place? Now, when the children do this, there's so many things happening. One thing that's happening is that every single one of them is learning about the biography of everyone else. Half of the audience walks out crying. And I find, because I have now been there so long, I see these children as adults. They can remember whose biography they did. And it also was a catalyst for doing more on their own. That's what I'm really looking for. Is that when I was done that in second grade, I continued throughout my life, when I saw an interesting person, to read about their life and to understand them. And that is the key element why I think biographies are so important. And they have to be introduced specifically, because otherwise nobody has time to read the story of Helen Keller or of Annie Sullivan, her teacher. Yes.
Do you give the names of, do you choose who they can do biographies of?
No, they choose.
Right.
They choose, but we...
Do you give a choice?
You're getting the nitty gritty. So what we're talking about here is you have to give them, like you have a list of personal qualities.
Yeah.
Do you have your, like...
Yeah, we have a profile, a school profile.
You have, like,
the
10 moral principles.
Yeah.
Yes,
in
we use
English.
The 10.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
People who exemplified one of these principles.
Okay.
To
mm-hmm.
you.
Mm-hmm.
For example, one boy chose Milton Hershey. Now, not too many of you know who Milton Hershey is, but you might know the name Hershey, okay, because he invented the Hershey bar. Now, the teacher looked at that and said, I don't understand, because he makes candy, why you think that that was one of these things. And the little boy who had done his research, was 7 years old, was able to say, because he treated his employees differently than every other manufacturer. Mm-hmm. So Mr. Hershey created a town where he treated people in a very progressive way. He then started a school for poor people, and then he ended up giving his entire fortune away by the time he passed. He was a great, great philanthropist and a very progressive thinker. So he was able to do Milton Hershey, but I guess my point being that if they have a list of qualities and they can say, you need to show me how this person exemplified one of those qualities. We have a similar barometer for neo-humanism in various areas. This is very important. For example, children like to raise money for charity. But we have a school policy that every year there are 4 prominent neo-humanist charities that we are promoting. And therefore, if you are going to sell lemonade and because you want to help a wallaby that got injured, half of your money has to go to one of the 4 neo-humanist charities. So now the neo-humanist charities are selected by the Neo-Humanist Honor Society, which Dee Dee and I have been talking to you about. This is a way of promoting good behavior. We have this honor society. They're selected by the older children every year. And the child who's doing the fundraising now has to go on the internet and research which one touches them the most. And so many times, after reading about these charities, they decided they wanted all the money to go there, and they decided that helping the wallaby was something that someone else could do, but oftentimes they split it. So we have a policy like that with, like, when you're going to go in the talent show and do a song, there's a quality check for the kind of song you're going to be singing, a new humanist quality check. There's a quality check for the kind of individual's biography you're going to do. So this neo-humanist quality check is what I'm trying to say exists throughout our school in various ways.
And I have a question.
Yeah. So you've got the classroom, and in the classroom there are the children, a teacher, and there's a problem arises with one of the children. Do you have in your school, some of the problems that you have could be not so big if the parents had been educated in some way in the beginning,
mm-hmm.
Or progressively, or regularly, or whatever, to help them understand that this is how we do this, this is how we solve problems at our school.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, do you have education for parents? So half the stuff that could arise is not so kind of dramatic or has a neat way of unfolding.
I'm going to very honestly say that we have not succeeded in that effort.
Okay.
We have tried.
Yeah.
And the people who don't need the education are the ones who come.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you don't have a compulsory
We do for, let's say, a student who is on a track towards being expelled from the school.
Okay. Yeah.
A student is on that track, which I believe you have created such a track.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There is a requirement for parent education.
Mm-hmm.
But that often will not come from us.
Uh-huh.
We will, for example, require them to attend some outside program about parenting or about whatever the specific issue might be.
Mm-hmm.
If it's dealing with a child who has attention deficit disorder, or if it's about setting limits, there are usually things available in the public that will tell them, in order for your child to continue, you have to attend this thing. We have not been good at doing that, but that's not because we don't think it's important. I agree with you so wholeheartedly.
Yeah.
It's the logistics of our particular situation, which is probably very different than yours, in that we're in an urban environment where people come from 28 different school districts, as far away as New York City and well, places you wouldn't recognize, very far distances. To get, we don't even have a parking lot big enough for people to come on one night. So it's difficult to have that kind of event for the logistic reasons. And then there's the quite practical issue of whether yours truly has the energy to stay at night and start doing these things. So I have tried to do it, and what I find again is I'm preaching to the choir. The people who need it are the ones who avoid it.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's very important, and I think it's a failing in our school, to be quite frank.
Yeah, I wonder if the answer is not in having evenings and so on, because life's so busy, whether it can be somehow integrated.
I believe there's a day on the schedule for problems we face as educators, and this is one that we should think about together.
That's
the same problem.
And we have a class on parent education too.
Make it compulsory before they even accept the registration.
Yeah, we've talked about that.
That you have to attend
the learning day.
Like as a parent, your child is not accepted into the school unless you actually attend these things.
Yeah.
So if you don't go, they're struck off.
And that's something we're looking into now.
But I think we need something more than that. I think we need something within the classroom that is of an evolving nature. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So grows with because everyone has support. Right? So here we have a problem where parents are not surviving because of mental, emotional, environmental issues. So here we have a level within the school where there's that support and platform for them. And this is love, you see? Because what we find it so hard to survive, you know?
It's preventative.
Comes to the children.
It's, yeah.
Yeah.
No, I understand. I've had this situation this year with a 5-year-old boy who was creating a lot of chaos in the classroom. And one of the things that came out in his imaginative play is that he was watching The Walking Dead, which is a pretty horrific show. I'm not sure that I can process that, let alone a 5-year-old.
Absolutely.
So there is not, that's because there is not that parent education piece where I can sit down with them and say, so I have to go to them individually and say, your son says he's watching The Walking Dead. And then of course the fathers, I find out that they're separated and he's with the father, and the father's watching The Walking Dead when he thinks the child is asleep. And, then I have to tell him. So we do it on an individual basis, but I believe that we need more. I think that very honestly, that's a weakness in our school, and I think that it would be something that I would have to learn about how I could make
society,
it better.
I think society, it's a societal, I think we need to look at loving and supporting each other more than we do, and not being more embracive and not so separate. Yeah. Anyway.
Eric, I just have a quick one, and I think that this might be something that we dive into more on Friday, because I think from what I hear our teachers talk about a lot is fitting this into the curriculum, like fitting this into the classroom, and how do we tick off our standards that we need to do for our curriculum in Australia.
I really believe that can be done,
yeah.
But not knowing the Australian standards, I can't give you the specifics, but if you taught me, I could give you ideas.
Yeah. Yeah, so I'd like to brainstorm with you at some point, or us together or something.
Well, we have
that
a curriculum meeting this afternoon.
Fabulous, and we can do that.
For elementary.
Because I think that's a major
and
concern.
Also for preschool with Dee Dee and for elementary with me.
Great.
But just as a quick example, if we want to train children, one of the things that we mentioned here was, social outlook. Teaching cardinal ethical principles. That can be done without taking any time. If the art and music and drama teacher are on board, okay, if you have the proper selection of literature that you're studying, now in Australia, is there required literature for each grade?
Yeah, absolutely, there's certain component. Oh, do you mean actual text?
No.
Oh, no, prescribed, no, no.
In high school there is that.
In high school, but not in our school, no.
The genres, they have genres.
We have genres,
yeah,
so we've got.
So the trick is somebody has to read thousands and thousands of books in English. I've already done that.
Yeah, yeah.
This is very hard work for me. You can imagine when I go to a foreign speaking country. Now you all speak English, so I probably know a lot of what's available. You can cover your language arts standards through teaching a book such as the book Shiloh, which is a story about why it's important to tell the truth. And it's a very, very profound story about telling the truth. But children and parents look at the book and they think it's a story about taking care of abused dogs. They're missing the point. The point of the book, which a good teacher would get, is that this boy chooses to lie to his parents because they won't give him what he wants. And it becomes a very religious conflict for him. So at the same time you're teaching about, at a very appropriate age, which is age 9, about the value of telling the truth, you're also teaching them about Christian theology. So I feel that it's important to expose children to religious ideals in various religions, but you don't have to do it directly. If you choose the right text, you can cover all your language arts bases and introduce these things. That's just a small example. The same thing can be done through thematic studies, which is something I like to study.
We do that.
Marcus quite a bit.
Yeah, we do thematic.
I wish my son could come here, but it was too hard to afford the travel. My son is an expert in this, and he's a teacher in the school. His name is Amal, and he designed, for example, a thematic unit for sixth grade, which began with cosmology, but it also covered ancient civilizations. What he got the children to do was to try to see the heavens from the point of view of an ancient person who would look up at the stars at night and see that they swirl in a specific pattern, except for a few, which seem to wander all over the place. So we'll call them the wanderers, which is the Greek word for planet. And they named each one for a specific reason. And those archetypes still exist today in terms of how the planets affect us, in terms of how we view the heavens. And he brought in poetry. So he brought in history, poetry, art, and cosmology, and he covered four different things that were required by New York State in this one thematic unit. He did something similar with the redwood trees, where he covered seven different topics in first grade just by studying the magnificent redwood trees of America and why are there only a few left and how old they are. So the thematic study, this is a lot of work.
I think that's where
teachers.
We might be going wrong too. I think that there's probably our themes are not based on neo-humanism. So we haven't, you know, we're doing a study around water, for example. We're not taking the neo-humanist approach in that. That's where I'm feeling maybe we're not doing it as well as we could.
Okay.
That's where I'm trying to, yeah.
Then you have to know how and
yeah.
what is neo-humanist.
That's right. And how you do your 2 hours of science, your 2 hours of maths, your 2 hours.
That's
right. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
And
that was wonderful.
It
thank
can
you.
Be done.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well,
oh, yeah. Absolutely.
And we'll get to go deeper into that.
Yeah, that'd be wonderful.
Sure.
Thank you.
It's now time for you to stand up.